have nerve endings everywhere, literally everywhere. And ordinarily, from these nerve endings, pain gets transmitted.
You can kind of think of them as your early warning system. They are the first line of defense that you have against threats in your environment.
So it could be a cut, it could be an incision, it could be something blunt. That initiates a chemical response that is transmitted to the spinal cord, then travel to the brain, and that's how pain is essentially perceived.
Now, this is in comparison to chronic pain. Chronic pain is essentially a maladaptive response, right? So this is an ongoing false alarm that really does not provide you or the body any benefit.
Pain medications and anesthetics utilize a very large number of different mechanisms. But in general, it's interrupting those pathways.
From wherever the insult or the incision is or the puncture is, and disrupt that communication to the spinal cord.
So that pain is ultimately not experienced.
There are a few different types of anesthesia that we use now. One is a local anesthetic, right, which many of you have probably experienced in your doctor's office or your dentist's office. We have regional anesthetic techniques, what we call monitored anesthesia care, which is a very deep sedation, and then general anesthesia. Regional anesthesia is an anesthetic technique by which we administer local anesthetics in and around large nerves that provide sensation to significant sections of our extremities or torso.
Those are sometimes done on nerves in the periphery, and sometimes they're done on nerves closer to the spinal cord. And that doesn't mean that it's dangerous because it's closer to the spinal cord. It just means that you're getting more nerve coverage the closer you get to the source of the nerves.
So for laboring women, the injection is around the low back. And so it numbs all the nerves from that injection site and a little bit above down to the feet. General anesthesia means that your body is completely asleep. You're not experiencing pain.
What we are doing is creating a space around both the brain and the body, which is characterized by unconsciousness, analgesia, amnesia, and paralysis, with the maintenance of physiologic function. And that physiologic function is monitored and maintained by your anesthesiologist while you are, as we say, sleeping.
Another type of anesthesia is IV anesthesia, which, like general anesthesia, it does afford one hypnosis and a level of numbness, but usually you're not deep to the point where you need a breathing device or your airway to be protected. This is commonly seen in cases like colonoscopies, endoscopy, or eye surgery.
Your basic physiology is not only being maintained, but the anesthesiologist focusing on you holistically and helping to make sure that you stay in good balance.
One of the things that we are seeing in anesthesia is really a move towards what we call a perioperative home, where patients are not under the care of an anesthesiologist only during the immediate preoperative and intraoperative period, but really becoming involved in care 3 to 6 months prior to a patient coming to surgery, during surgery, and then their postoperative care afterwards. And chronic pain medicine provides an ability to attenuate risk factors for the development of chronic pain after surgery, as well as to facilitate the development of comprehensive pain plans to minimize discomfort in the postoperative period, both in and out of the hospital.
It's a very exciting time in anesthesia. We're always interrogating and really asking the questions, what does the data show? So that we can do this shared decision-making with our patients. Anesthesiology has become extraordinarily safe, both because of the monitoring that we have, the medication that we have, and the vigilance